Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Death of the Universe, Hard Science Fiction, by Brandon Q. Morris. Narrated by David Stifel. Cycle YA7.3, K2-288BB. Breakfast, John? Kepler lifted his head. This butler annoyed him. Johannes, how many times do I have to tell you?
Excuse me, Johannes.
The butler pronounced the name with an English J, incorrectly. Kepler sighed.
Think of it as a Y, Johannes.
Why, Johannes?
Never mind. Just call me Kepler. He got up from the seat in which he had spent the night in sleep mode. He imagined fresh coffee and croissants.
Very well, said the butler. I'll call you Kepler.
The butler bowed flawlessly, as far as Kepler could tell, and led him into the neighboring room. Where did Zhen Yi ever get this antiquated model? He estimated its age to be at least 2 kilocycles. Old-world butlers had come into fashion again then for a short time. He had externalized his memories of that year on Terra, so he couldn't remember any other details. But this butler could be several mega-years old. Who knew these days? Kepler wondered whether he should ask him, but that seemed somehow improper. The butler was a machine, but he played his role so believably that Kepler felt a certain respect for him.
Please excuse me, Venerable Kepler, said the butler, for not meeting your language requirements. My vocalization memory is no longer as flexible since the last megaflare from K2-288B.
Why haven't you repaired it?
It wasn't a priority.
Of course, Kepler thought. How long had Zhen Yi been underway? The butler hadn't had anything to do for a few cycles, until Kepler's arrival on K2-288BB.
Your breakfast, said the butler,
pointing at the table. The table looked like it was made of wood. It was an exceptional imitation. You could almost smell the scent of the hardwood. The room was bathed in atmospheric light. The walls glowed a warm yellow. On the far side, a fire blazed in a fireplace. Kepler went around the table. The fire radiated heat. Flames licked around the logs. Such excellent work. Zhen Yi had always had a penchant for luxury. These weren't algorithms at work. The hologram had to have been designed by a human. There were only 2 holographic masters capable of something like this. Kepler knelt in front of the fireplace. The master must have left his signature behind somewhere. Maybe he'd recognize it. He stretched out his hand to lift up the uppermost log. Ouch! Kepler cried out in shock, pulling back his hand. Either the hologram had no safety circuit or... Butler, what's wrong with this hologram? Kepler looked at the hand he had held in the flames. 2 large blisters were forming on the skin, white in the middle and pink around the edges. He activated the pain sensors that had automatically switched themselves off, appreciating the pain. The wounds burned like hell. He concentrated his perception on them. This was life. It wasn't so easy to be in touch with it anymore.
The fireplace is not a hologram, said the butler. The wood comes from Terra.
Was that something resembling pride in his voice? If he hadn't misheard, then this butler couldn't be a level 1 AI as prescribed for ordinary servants. That would fit with Zhen Yi. She liked pushing boundaries. But what had the butler just said? Kepler swung around to face the flames again. Real wood was burning in this fireplace. Kepler couldn't believe it. Doubtless Zhen Yi knew what she was doing. She was burning biomass, organically grown. There had been no forests on Terra for a long time now. The last tree had been incinerated when the sun had expanded into a red giant megacycles ago. Or was the butler lying to him? Level 1 AIs couldn't lie, and neither could a level 2 if Zhenyi had upgraded him illegally. Kepler stood up. He breathed deeply, then turned back to the table. Was the food also biologically generated? Nothing here would surprise him now.
"Please have a seat," said the butler, pulling out the only chair.
Kepler walked around the table and accepted the invitation. The butler pushed the chair in. The wood creaked as he sat down. In front of him stood a large plate and a glass. It was a simple drinking glass, transparent, a narrow cylindrical shape holding a colorless liquid. He picked it up and took a sip. It contained cool, clear water with almost no taste. On the plate were mixed vegetables and half a roasted fowl, probably a chicken, but Kepler wasn't sure. In the last few kilocycles, he had nourished himself bio-optimally. The chicken could also be a pigeon or a duck. He could no longer remember the actual size of these terrestrial animals. This knowledge was most likely among the memories he had externalized. It was the only way to stop the memory load over so many megacycles from gradually poisoning his brain. He reached for the cutlery. A fork and knife lay on either side of his plate. He carefully sliced off a piece of the animal flesh, pushed it into his mouth, and closed his eyes. It was chicken. There was no mistaking it. He hadn't forgotten that flavor. He chewed thoroughly and swallowed, then opened his eyes again. "This is chicken," he said.
"Very good, Johannes," answered the butler. "You're the first guest in a long time who's recognized it."
Johannes again? Oh, well, he couldn't help it. Kepler was amused, in spite of himself, at the way the butler praised him, like one would praise a small child. "Is it from Terra?" he asked. The butler smiled.
"No. You know yourself that's not possible."
Kepler nodded. Terra had been dead for megacycles. The organic material of the chicken would long since have decomposed. Nanofabricators must have manufactured it here on K2-288BB. But the wood?
"That was a happy coincidence."
"Coincidence?"
"A 99er had a cargo of wood. The ship had made a complete circuit of the Milky Way, but the wood had hardly aged. Zhenyi bought it."
That was a more or less believable explanation. At 99% of the speed of light, time passes very slowly. But this wood must have enormous value. And his friend was simply burning it? "Why doesn't Zhenyi build something out of it?" he asked.
"I can't speak for my owner, but this table is built from the wood. I have instructions to ensure the utmost comfort of the guests."
"Thank you. I'm honored," said Kepler. He wouldn't get any more than that out of the butler. Butler AIs were optimized to evade uncomfortable questions. Instead, he concentrated on the food. The chicken was genuinely delicious. The fibers of the meat almost melted on his tongue. The skin was browned and had a pleasant aroma. The combination of vegetables perfectly enhanced the flavor with herbs and sweet notes. Kepler pushed back the chair. His plate was empty. "It was a real pleasure," he said. The butler bowed, then passed him a moist napkin. Kepler wiped his mouth and hands with it.
"I didn't want to bother you while you were eating, but the 99er that you've been expecting has announced it will be arriving tomorrow."
Finally, an end to all the waiting, Kepler thought. He took a deep breath in, then slowly let it out. This body was perfect, but he had been getting tired of it, especially in the last few days. He didn't feel at home in it. Thank you very much for the meal, Kepler said with a faint bow. I'll go to my room now.
Of course. I'll wake you in plenty of time before the ship arrives.
Cycle YA7.4 K2-288BB. Kepler opened the airlock hatch with a forceful shove. The moisture in the air froze immediately and rose as white vapor. He climbed up the short ladder. By the second step, the skin on his hands was already discolored. First it turned white, then gray, then the skin froze. No wonder, at an exterior temperature of minus 180 degrees, Kepler switched off the pain sensors. He didn't have time now for ancient biological sensitivities. The surface was in perpetual twilight. The planet orbited in a captured rotation around its star, K2-288b, which hung like a dim lamp above him. The disk of the sun was big in the sky, but no longer gave off much heat. Many gigacycles ago, this planet must have been in the habitable zone, but now it was dead, and so cold that even the atmosphere had frozen, spread across the surface in a blanket of snow and ice. His lungs were stinging. He needed to be more careful. Kepler stopped breathing. It would be stupid if this body failed before he had reached the ship. He would wake up in another replacement body, but he would have wasted precious time. He had failed to really appreciate it for so long. Time. If you're immortal, it doesn't hold much meaning. But that had changed since he found out that the end was coming. Kepler walked across the dry snow, which crunched under his feet with each step. His body conducted the sound, which he otherwise wouldn't be able to sense with no atmosphere. The soles of his athletic shoes were thin. He put his right hand into his pants pocket. That wasn't a good idea, because the skin on the back of his hand came away, revealing the gleaming blue metal underneath. It always disgusted him to see his surrogate body in this state. The ship came into view. It looked like a huge tin can. It had left its interstellar propulsion system in orbit. For safety reasons, it had landed a short distance away from Zhen Yi's home. Humans were infallible, but they hadn't managed to transfer this quality to the things they built. That was the dilemma of the times and of past gigacycles. Kepler was frequently preoccupied with these kinds of thoughts. It was a problem that humans shared with the God from the Bible. No creation can be considered perfect if you don't acknowledge that you're too stupid to recognize perfection. This led to only two possible conclusions. Either there was no God, or God was one of them. For some reason, he preferred the second possibility.
"Hello, Kepler," said the ship's AI in a female voice. "Nice of you to greet us personally."
Us? Had the AI split? That sometimes happened when ships were underway too long, but more commonly on 95ers, where the onboard time went much slower. Interstellar transporters were usually equipped with at least a level 3 AI. They were much more adaptable, but also more sensitive.
"Well, say something, Kepler," the AI admonished him. "It's impolite not to reply."
"I was just thinking about the us."
"Come on, Kepler. Don't you recognize us?"
He was confounded. He had never taken an interest in which AIs controlled which ships. He was only concerned with the cargo. What's up with this AI?
"Kepler, don't you remember the convention at Sagittarius A star at all?"
A ship's AI asking him about the convention, where it had been decided to end the universe?
Then it occurred to him, of course. There were two people who had set themselves up on board a 99er, the Curies. But were they also using it as a transporter?
"Marie, Pierre, is that you?" Man, it took long enough for the penny to drop, said a male voice.
He recognized Pierre Curie's voice. He had given a speech at the convention.
Excuse me, said Kepler. I hadn't expected you two to be carrying out transport orders. It just happened to work out that way. We wanted to speak with you anyway, and this way you pay us for the trip.
I understand. It must have been an enormous coincidence, you seeing my order on HR8799B. Does Zhenyi know about your visit?
We've been following you for a while, Kepler. You change systems so often it's as though you're on the run. We haven't yet reached Zhenyi. She must be underway somewhere in the direction of the Galactic Center.
What was it you wanted from me? Kepler asked.
We'll explain that over a good red wine. We always have a few bottles in our luggage.
Agreed. A hatch opened in the ship just above the ground. Kepler only noticed because vapor was pouring out of it, tinted red by the sun. He moved closer. Two rectangular objects emerged, side by side. They were lying on a thin trestle that had many small jointed legs. The objects walked their way over to him. The movement looked so absurd, like a cockroach in high heels, that he had to laugh, even though it wasn't the first time he'd seen it.
That's right. Laugh at us, said Marie Curie.
The objects walked past him. They seemed to know where the airlock was located. He moved quickly, which was sweaty work in this high gravity, caught up with them, and then walked beside the second one. Without the strange little legs, the things would look like snow-white coffins. They seemed to be made of glass or some other semi-transparent substance, but the material was so milky that the contents couldn't be made out. Which of the two caskets contained the cargo he had been awaiting for so long? Next to the personnel airlock, another much bigger hatchway had opened. In the center of it was a platform. The two caskets positioned themselves on it and traveled downwards. Kepler climbed down the ladder into the airlock. He had to wait for it to fill with air. He scratched impatiently at the dead skin on his hand. He should leave it alone, but his excitement was building. Finally, the door opened. He started breathing again. The air was so warm and moist it made him feel sick. Why hadn't he noticed that before? The butler beckoned him and led him into the living room. The table was no longer there. The two caskets stood in its place. He arrived just in time to see the left-hand casket open with a squelching sound. A fit-looking, naked male torso rose up out of it. The skin was almost without pigment. There was no hair on its head. The creature looked around, then pulled a tube out of its forearm and removed the sensor stuck to its chest. It cleared its throat, but didn't say anything. Then it supported itself on the edge of the casket and stood up, while the little thin legs of the casket bent at the knees. Its lower half was also naked. There were no genitalia, or at least none that Kepler could make out. He had never seen the Curies like this. He blushed involuntarily. A primitive reaction, he thought. But they could have said something if my presence bothered them. The creature climbed skillfully out of the casket. It was slightly smaller than he was. Kepler tried to compare his memories of Pierre Curie with the image of this naked being, but couldn't. Hadn't the Curies participated at the convention in another body? He couldn't remember anymore.
First of all, we'll take a shower, said the Curies in Pierre's voice. And you'll obviously need some time to unpack your consignment.
Kepler had to tear his eyes away from the naked form that Pierre and Marie Curie shared. It made absolute sense economically. They only needed to maintain one body, but he wouldn't have been able to do it. Another voice in your head? That must be horrible. The Curies had been a couple for gigacycles, but that time surely hadn't gone by without conflict.
and if they had an argument, neither would be able to leave the star system to temporarily escape the other. The door closed loudly. He was alone. Kepler went and stood beside the second casket. A delicate moment lay ahead of him. How long had he been waiting now to be reunited? He had reached K2-228BB at the speed of light. He always used a laser transfer when he traveled, even though it was very expensive. But that meant he had to wait longer at the destination, because only the data containing his consciousness could be moved at light speed, not his physical body. He operated two old-fashioned levers mounted one on either side of the casket. Then the lid rose, and he was looking himself in the face. It seemed wrong, as though left and right had been reversed, but that was how it should appear to him, as this wasn't a mirror image, but the original. Before him lay Johannes Kepler, or to be precise, his flesh shell, cloned however many times from his own cells. He had chosen the name himself, ages ago. It was his body, and therefore himself. Like most humans, he found it difficult to live outside his shell for long periods, as unsuitable as it may be for survival in space. And now he'd been stuck far too long in this robot. "Butler, please prepare the transfer," he said.
"Of course, Johannes."
He pronounced the J correctly. Had he finally repaired his vocalizer? A door opened to his left. The butler came in with a couple of cables. Kepler opened his shirt.
"We need to repair those hands," said the butler. "Did you go outside without a suit?"
Kepler nodded.
"You realize that it will mean your death after the transfer?"
"Of course. This isn't my first time."
"Good. I'm obliged to point that out to you. It's protocol."
The butler attached sensors to Kepler's chest and temples. Then he guided a cable into his ear. It tickled. The butler then connected the cables to the body in the casket.
"That's it," he said. "You can start the transfer."
"Thank you," Kepler replied. The butler left. Kepler deactivated the robot's skeletal system so it wouldn't collapse and be damaged. Then he summoned the body's vital signs into his field of vision. The body temperature was 32 degrees. The heart was beating once per minute. Going in would be uncomfortable. There was a reason the Curies preferred traveling in their shared body. Kepler took a deep breath. Then his thoughts gave the command to begin. It was cold, freezing cold. He searched feverishly for curse words to distract him from the cold. Bloody cold. Fucking cold. His heart was hammering. He tried to call up his heart rate into his field of vision, but nothing happened. Then he remembered he was back in his body. If he wanted to see something his five senses weren't made for, he needed an external device. He rubbed his hands together. His muscles didn't obey at first, but gradually things improved. He touched his body. Where he couldn't feel anything, he rubbed vigorously. He warmed himself up from the outside in. Maybe he should have raised the room temperature first. Then he noticed how warm it seemed to be. The butler must have thought of that himself. The pain gradually became bearable. He pulled his legs in toward his body. The muscles tingled intensely, but obeyed his command. He gripped the edge of the casket with his arms and pulled himself upright. Why is it so difficult? Of course, this planet was significantly larger than the Earth. If he were to plan any long hikes, he'd need an exoskeleton. But there was no reason to spend long periods on the surface. He was sitting. The feeling was coming back into his skin. He had done it. He was back in his body. He was no longer all-powerful and invincible. In his body, he was vulnerable. Without tools, he wouldn't survive long.
It was as if this alone had given life new meaning.
Kepler knew the feeling well. He'd lost count. How many times had he already been through this?
The body only ever lasted a few hundred cycles. Then he had to move on.
He was more or less addicted to traveling. Travel was his drug. It helped him block out the current state of the world. The Curies were right. He was on the run. He was running from pure existence.
Each of the maybe 10,000 humans that still existed solved this problem in their own way, because it was difficult to watch others die.
It would be unbearable if the universe itself were to die a slow death.
Cycle YA7.5 K2-288BB.
Do you know where this ash came from?
The Curies were crouching in front of the fireplace in which the fire had burned 2 days ago, fingering the remnants with their left hand.
No idea, he said. The ash is still slightly warm, said Pierre's voice. The butler turned up the heating in here yesterday to make my transfer easier.
The Curies stood up. Their face smiled stiffly.
You're lying, but we'll leave it at that, said Marie.
Of course he was lying.
He couldn't exactly admit that he had allowed the entropy to be increased in such a senseless way. The universe was about to die because it was losing energy, and chaos was increasing, and he was burning essential resources to ash.
No, I'm not lying. I didn't light a fire.
And that was true. He cleared his throat.
I actually came here to be alone, he said.
You're here to be alone?
Yes, that was the idea.
That was the idea?
That's what the Curies were like. Their reputation preceded them. He shouldn't let it get to him.
Kepler crossed his arms and smiled. All was quiet for a while.
Marie was obviously waiting for him to say something so that she could parrot it, but he wasn't going to do her the favor, even though he wanted to know why they were here.
You have to admit you could have gone almost anywhere. The Milky Way has 300 billion planets. We searched them all. Well, nearly all. Almost none of them present any threat of company. And yet you chose K2-288BB in particular, where Wang Zhenyi has constructed a base. You must have realized that the risk of meeting her here was quite high.
Yes, I was quite lucky she wasn't here.
No, Johannes, said Pierre. We inquired about you, even though it took a few megacycles.
You have a shared past with Zhenyi. What did you want from her?
Nothing at all. I just wanted to be alone. She's rarely ever home.
I don't find that very plausible, said Marie. Given the many alternatives where you would have been guaranteed solitude.
I don't care, he said.
That wasn't true.
He found the questions uncomfortable, and the Curies were intimidating him, but he couldn't let it show. He'd chosen his destination deliberately. He'd hoped to meet Zhenyi here, and he was still hoping she would arrive someday.
We're wondering why you're not telling us the truth, said Pierre. Why are you really here?
I already told you.
Marie sighed. We're not getting anywhere with this, she said. You don't need to be afraid of us. We're friends.
Friends? He didn't know anyone who was friends with the Curies. Gagarin and Armstrong, maybe. Or Hahn and Meitner, the other physicist couple.
How long has it been since I've seen those two?
I'm not afraid. I just don't know what you want from me, he said.
We don't want anything from you at all, said Marie. It's about Zhenyi. We heard she's undermining the rescue project.
And what's that got to do with me?
You traveled a few hundred light years to visit her.
Fine. I wanted to talk to her and couldn't be bothered waiting hundreds of cycles for a reply.
You could have put yourself on ice like everyone else does, said Pierre. Kepler shook his head.
It had, in fact, become common practice to sleep for long periods while waiting for a reply. If your correspondent was 100 light years away, you could still speak entirely normally with each other as long as you spent the 200 cycles of waiting time in a state of unconsciousness. But the time that was left to them was no longer endless. Since he had become aware of that fact, he had been trying to do without such methods. But in that case, he'd rather not bother with conducting conversations.
It's not for me, he said. I find it wasteful.
Fine, said Pierre.
The Curies wandered up and down the room. It looked as though they were deep in thought, but in reality they were probably conversing with one another without him being able to hear them. Kepler stood up, went over to the fireplace, and crouched in front of it. The ash really was warm. He ran his fingers through it. He really must take care of this body. If something happened to him like what happened 2 days ago, there could be dire consequences in spite of the nanofabricators. His index finger touched something cool, round. Kepler wanted to take it out and have a look, but he thought better of it. Maybe it wasn't a coincidence. The object must have been hidden in the wood. Had Zhen Yi left him a message? He couldn't read it as long as the Curies were still here. He stood up again and wiped his ashy fingers on his pale cotton pants. The butler would scold him when he saw the stains. The pants had only been made yesterday. Kepler sat down on what was still the only chair. The butler had cleared away the caskets, but he'd not brought an extra chair. He didn't particularly like the Curies either, it seemed. Kepler couldn't blame him. They were brilliant scientists. They had developed the process that was supposed to lead to the rebooting of Sagittarius A star as a quasar. And now they were obsessing over such trivialities as his visit to Zhen Yi. Something wasn't right.
So what did you want to talk to Zhen Yi about? Asked Marie.
About my experiences on HR8799B. You can't imagine how dense the asteroid belt is there, he said. You know that we can effect an extraction of your externalized memories, asked Pierre. But for that to happen, I have to be under suspicion of having committed a crime. You need a warrant from the Judge AI on Terra. The Earth is far away. The request alone would take a few kilocycles. The answer even longer.
That's true, said Marie.
And her tone sounded conciliatory. That's why we wanted to speak with you personally. You have nothing to fear from us.
Kepler wasn't so sure about that. Marie articulated the last sentence in a way that made it sound like a threat. She was really good at this. If he had known something, would he have spilled it? But he didn't know anything. What even gives you the right to interrogate me like this? You're wasting your time, he said.
I have that impression too, said Pierre. We should go.
Yes, we should.
When the couple spoke aloud to one another, they almost seemed insane. Was it really such a good idea to surrender yourself like that to someone else? Kepler was glad he'd never needed to, even with Zhen Yi, whom he had truly loved a long time ago. Cycle YA7.6, K2-288BB. Kepler bowed, as was customary for goodbyes. The Curies climbed back into the casket. The butler had suggested providing them with a spacesuit, but they had declined. The lid closed, and the oblong glass object made its way on its little legs back to their ship. It had been a short visit. What would they be saying about him now? They obviously didn't believe him. He had come here to meet Zhen Yi. He had hoped that maybe she still felt something for him, and that she'd lend him money. His constant fleeing was expensive,
you couldn't get a 99er for under 100,000 gigs, even for a short trip of 100 light years. 1 gig was a gigawatt year, itself quite an enormous amount of energy. But to accelerate a ship to near light speed, that consumed a lot of energy and was therefore expensive, even with the newest technology. The technology itself hadn't developed in the last few megacycles. The remaining humans had other things to do. They were preoccupied with themselves, or with the rescue project. Every individual received, for their personal use, a fixed proportion of the total energy produced by humans. But even the number of Dyson spheres, which sucked energy from the stars, was no longer growing. And at the same time, the stars were gradually being extinguished. The universe had grown old, and humanity had become stagnant. Zhenyi had allegedly inherited huge energy reserves from her ancestors. She was rumored to be epically rich. No one knew where or how she was storing her provisions, and she hadn't even confided in him so far. Kepler guessed that it was stored somewhere as potential energy in a gravitational field, but she could also have it stored chemically. He imagined a solar system in which the planets consisted of frozen hydrogen. He had queried her when they'd last met. He must have chosen the wrong moment. She was probably expecting a more romantic utterance. Women. No loan had been forthcoming. She had simply recommended that he forego the extravagance of traveling in his biological body. A modulated laser beam only needed a third of the power from a medium Dyson sphere. But Zhenyi didn't understand. He needed this body, not just any old surrogate. Even when he was always on the move, he needed something to make him feel at home. How was that supposed to work with a robot body manufactured at the destination? Just once he traveled as pure energy. He hadn't been able to get hold of a 99er before the convention in the orbit of Sagittarius A star. The human fleet had already been decimated by that time. He looked back on the experience with nothing but horror. The outposts were overflowing, 10,000 visitors. The organizers probably wouldn't even be able to imagine such a massive number of people anymore. Today it was an incredible coincidence for three individuals to find themselves in the same place, if you excluded multi-beings like the Curies. Kepler had only vaguely followed the discussion itself. It had been about the rescue project. The arguments for it, presented by Pierre Curie, seemed to him conclusive, which was why he had voted in favor. However, a vocal minority had turned against it. He could only remember a few names. Einstein, Plato, and Scott were among them. He hadn't heard anything of them since, but that didn't mean anything. Of the roughly 10,000 present in orbit around the black hole, he had only heard again from three, the Curies and Zhenyi, and he hadn't even seen his friend in that time.
Johannes, may I prepare you a meal?
The butler pulled him out of his thoughts, but he didn't mind. That would be very kind, he answered.
What about an English breakfast?
I would prefer lunch.
Zhenyi says you prepare an excellent steak. Well, I have to give the credit to the nanobots, but the recipe, as far as I know, is only available in my memory stores. The butler lowered his head a little. This reemphasized his modesty.
Excellent work, thought Kepler.
The AI knew precisely how to influence humans. It was definitely higher than a level one. But it didn't matter to him. In the past, he had developed and optimized artificial intelligence. If only he had optimized his own intelligence enough to have thought of ensuring the presence of his hostess before the journey began. But he had simply trusted that Zhenyi would be staying at her base. The problem was that his provisions were now so exhausted he would never be able to leave here again without a hefty credit. So, he'd have to wait for Zhenyi, for better or worse. The moment the butler served the steak, Kepler stopped resenting having to stay there for an indefinite period. Even the aroma was indescribable. If he excluded the unlikely possibility that Zhen Yi was running a cattle ranch, then it was genuinely masterful nano-programming. The tiny machines didn't just have to constitute the meat from its raw materials. They also had to emit, at just the right moment, precisely the aroma his nose expected from the perfect steak. He couldn't even name it. The butler stood next to him with pepper grinder raised.
"May I sprinkle some Madagascar pepper over your steak?"
"Please." The grinder was flourished in an elegant motion about 20 centimeters above the steak, so that a fine mist of pepper was strewn across it. Kepler was reminded a little of the ashes in the fireplace. They were the same color. The metal orb! Hopefully the butler hadn't disposed of the remnants. Kepler looked over at the fireplace. From here, he couldn't tell whether it had been cleaned.
"Is something not right?" asked the butler.
"The steak is perfect."
"But?"
"I was just wondering about the fireplace."
"The fireplace? Should I light it? I'm afraid I must disappoint you. Miss Wong clearly instructed me to light the fire only once, and under no circumstances to clean it."
"Didn't that make you wonder?" Maybe that was the wrong question. If Zhen Yi had left instructions specifically for him, then she must also have known he was coming. But how? She must have come across his transport order from HR8799B, like the Curie's. So then why in the world had she not waited for him? Was she afraid, perhaps?
"Well, Johannes, it's not my place to wonder about my mistress's decisions," said the butler.
"I feel a bit like you're mocking me right now, at the risk of sounding impolite," he answered.
"What do you mean, Johannes?"
"You're at least a level 2 AI, but I'm guessing more like a level 4. But even as a level 2, you'd have no other choice than to wonder. It's part of the definition of that level, to evaluate every decision and every command."
"Well, that may be true, Johannes, in which case I obviously evaluated the instruction and found it to be correct. But I'm not obligated to give an account of it."
"That's true."
"Thank you, Johannes. I would like to draw your attention to the fact that your steak is getting cold."
"Thank you." Kepler reached for the cutlery again. So, the orb was waiting for him in the ashes. He could take the time to enjoy a good meal. He should always make time for that. Who knew what tomorrow would bring? He lay the cutlery aside, and the butler cleared the table. Kepler leaned back. His stomach was uncomfortably full, and under his shirt, sweat was running down his back. He needed to get used to his biological body again. Life was much more intense in it, but that also had its downside.
"A cognac for the digestion?" asked the butler. "We have an exclusive selection."
It was an enticing offer. He wouldn't put it past Zhen Yi to have somehow come into possession of a physically distilled cognac, maybe even one from Terra. No, that was impossible. No beverage kept that long. "Thank you for the offer, but I'll decline," Kepler replied. "I'm very warm. Could you please lower the temperature by 2 degrees? The butler bowed his head.
"Gladly."
Kepler stretched out his legs and let his arms hang at his sides. It was good he was alone. If Zhen Yi were on the other side of the table, he wouldn't want to let himself go like this. Solitude had its undeniable advantages, and the butler didn't sulk when he contradicted him. He wasn't sure why. If it was a level 4 AI, it had a complete emotional spectrum. He should get up and have a look at the orb, but there would be time for that later. He closed his eyes and fell asleep.
Cycle YA7.7. K2-288BB.
Kepler woke up bathed in sweat. He was lying in bed. The blanket had wrapped itself around his left leg. He kicked it away. He must have been having an intense dream. But hadn't he still been sitting at the table when he fell asleep? Kepler patted his body. He was clearly wearing pajamas. The butler must have brought him to bed and removed his clothes. Or removed his clothes and then brought him to bed. He imagined the elegantly attired butler throwing a naked man over his shoulder and carrying him to the bedroom. How had he managed it without waking him? His body was probably to blame. The first few days after being reunited were always tiring. For his body, only a few weeks had gone by aboard the 99er, but biological muscles resented not being used for that long. He had complained many times to the manufacturers of the cryostasis chambers, but there was no more progress there. The demand for the transport of biological bodies was minimal, because most humans were content with robot bodies. And every engineer and researcher who was still active was occupied with the rescue project. "Light on," he said. Nothing happened. That must have been one of Zhen Yi's quirks. They actually suited each other well, as extravagant as their behavior was in other people's eyes. Kepler got up. There must be a light switch on the wall somewhere. Zhen Yi was nuts. He felt his way across the room blindly. His shin bumped into an obstacle, presumably a chair. A sharp pain shot through his consciousness. He wanted to curse, but he couldn't think of anything suitable. Then his hands finally found the wall. He moved to the right. There was a door frame. He moved his hands up and finally found the switch. The bedroom was quite small. It contained a bed, an antique-looking wardrobe, and a chair. His things were hung over the chair. They were perfectly folded. But why had the butler put him to bed in here, and not in the guest room he usually used? Kepler looked down at himself. The pajamas fit perfectly. But they weren't the same ones he'd had on the previous night. Maybe those were in the laundry. Kepler opened the door. The light in the corridor went on automatically. Left or right? He couldn't remember which way led to the living room. He chose right. After a few meters, he went past a door. Was that the living room? He opened the door and had to steady himself on the frame. He had almost plunged into space. The universe spread out before him. But he could still breathe. Kepler felt in front of him. There was no transparent wall, so it must have been a projection. He looked at the constellations. Up and to the right he could see the spiral of Andromeda. This reproduction must be ancient. The M31 galaxy Andromeda had long since merged with the Milky Way. What was Zhen Yi's interest in the past? He closed the door. A short way along, the corridor ended in another door. He opened it and entered the living room. The butler was sitting on a chair in front of the fireplace and looking into it, as though he was watching a fire. But he must have been in sleep mode. Kepler cleared his throat. The butler turned to him and eyed him with raised eyebrows. He seemed to find the pajamas unsuitable. But Kepler couldn't do anything about that just now.
"Good morning, Johannes," said the butler, standing up. "Shall I prepare breakfast?"
"A steak would be good," he replied. "No, wait. I will have breakfast. English, please."
A steak would just make him sleepy again. He shouldn't sleep through the day again, or his body would never get fit.
"Then I must ask for 15 minutes of your patience," said the butler.
He bowed and left the living room through a door that Kepler hadn't even noticed before. Damn it! He'd wanted to ask the butler why he'd spent the night in Zhen Yi's room. Kepler looked around. He wanted to pull up a chair, but then he noticed the fireplace. He knelt in front of it and rummaged in the ashes with his left hand. They were still warm. That was strange. The orb was still there. He pulled it out, shook it, and polished away the ashes. He inspected the orb, turning it in his fingers. It gleamed metallically and radiated a certain amount of heat. Maybe it was the residual warmth of the ashes, or his own body heat. Metals conduct heat well. He closed his hand around the orb. It fit perfectly in his fist. Kepler closed his eyes. The orb seemed to be vibrating. He opened his hand and examined it. There was nothing there that could vibrate. It must have just been his own heartbeat. What was the point of this? Was Zhenyi allowing herself a joke with him, leaving him a riddle to pass the time? That wasn't her style. If she had something to say, she said it. The orb was an encrypted message. But why didn't she just tell the butler what to convey to Kepler? If it was a level 4 AI, it could also lie if the wrong person questioned it. Zhenyi must not have trusted her own butler. There was no other explanation. But he obviously knew about the orb. Kepler rubbed the orb in the hope that a genie would materialize, like in fairy tales, but it didn't respond. He pictured Zhenyi. She was the most intelligent woman he'd ever met, and an excellent psychologist. It wasn't about the message, at least not primarily. It was about him. "I've seen through you, Zhenyi," he said, and was shocked to hear his own voice. His ex-girlfriend wanted to draw him in. If he occupied himself with the orb, he would develop an interest in whatever secret was concealed in it. And it must be a big, dangerous secret for Zhenyi to have gone to such lengths. She was probably trying to rescue the world again. Giga cycles ago, she had already tried to prevent the collision of the Milky Way and Andromeda, because there was a small risk that the Sun, along with Terra, would be flung out of the system. No one had taken her seriously, including himself. That had been the reason for their first separation. But in the end, nothing happened. Terra was still orbiting in the backyard of the new, now elliptical galaxy. If the butler had said, "Kepler, coming to help my boss rescue the world," he would have politely declined. But now that he was holding the strange orb in his hand, he couldn't resist wanting to find out its meaning. Zhenyi was clever. Kepler sat down at the table with the orb. He held it in both hands and tried to twist it open, but his fingers just slipped. He shook it. But there seemed to be nothing movable inside it. In any case, it wasn't hollow. He held it right up to his eyes. Maybe there was fine lettering on the surface, but there was nothing. The surface was polished smooth and perfectly round. Perhaps he should observe it under the microscope or cut it open. No, he could always destroy it later. Kepler yawned. His body was ready to sleep again. He placed the orb on the wooden tabletop and lay his head down next to it. This made the orb look bigger. The tabletop was pleasantly cool. He let go of the orb and it rolled toward him until it bumped against his nose. He sat back upright and held the orb still. "The table is a bit uneven," he said. No answer. But he was used to being alone after all. That came from never having any company when traveling. The door on the back wall opened. It was the butler, who else? Kepler was surprised by the fact that he was surprised. He really must pay more attention to his mental health. The butler set the breakfast down on the table. The plate was covered, but it smelled tantalizingly of fried eggs and toast. The butler brought a large white cup and poured tea into it. Kepler observed the surface of the liquid. It appeared to be level. "Wait a minute."
He placed the orb on the table again on the same spot. It rolled in the same direction as before.
"Is it possible this table is uneven?" he asked, although the tea had already given him the answer.
"Not at all, no. The table was absolutely precisely manufactured," said the butler.
"Then why is the ball rolling?" He placed it on the table again, and again it moved toward him.
"Let's see," said the butler.
He took a napkin from the table, folded it several times, and pushed it under the table leg at the corner the orb had rolled toward.
"Try it now."
Kepler placed the orb on the table. It rolled toward him at just the same speed as before.
"That's baffling," said the butler.
"I think so, too." Kepler stood up and lifted the table with his right hand by the corner under which the butler had put the napkin. Now the tabletop was obviously uneven.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.